Hey everyone, Patrick LeBlanc, Principal Program Manager for Microsoft Fabric. In this video, we've got some awesome demos lined up for data factory orchestration. We'll be showcasing OneLake file triggers for pipelines, parameter support for Spark job definition pipeline activities, and so much more. First up, we have an exciting demo from Mark. Mark, let's take it away.
Hey, Data Factory fans. Today, I'm going to give you a real short demo of using OneLake file triggers inside of Fabric Data Factory. So now what you can do is you can invoke your pipeline when a file arrives inside of a folder in your lakehouse, and we call that a OneLake file trigger. So the way to do that is take your pipeline. You see on my screen, I have a very super simple pipeline with just a single wait activity. Not super realistic, but at least it's something I can use to demonstrate. What I'm going to do then is I'm going to click Add Trigger. And then here I will have the options of a different kind of source that I can use. Now, previously we only allowed Azure Blob Store as a file trigger, but now we also allow you to use OneLake. So you'll pick OneLake events right here from the picker, which is a new screen that you'll have instead of just defaulting to Azure Blob Store. You can still do Azure Blob Store triggers if you like. But then you can select the type of file events, the same kind of events that you would see in Azure Blob Store, so that you can trigger your pipeline when a file arrives, is deleted, renamed, and same thing at the folder level as well. I'll just keep all of those events selected for a demo, and then I'm going to pick my OneLake source, and I will use my lakehouse. And this has to be a folder because it only works with files. So inside of my files, I have a folder called trigger test. I'm going to select that. That's checked. And now when a file is modified inside of that trigger test folder, my pipeline will be invoked. I just have to tell Fabric which data activator I want to use for that trigger and go ahead and create. And a few seconds later, you'll have your trigger, and then we can test this by dropping a file or deleting a file from that folder. So now over here on my lakehouse, I'm going to pick that trigger test folder, and I'm going to drop a file. I'm going to drop my new functions.txt file, and the upload is complete. And now we should see the pipeline has been triggered over here on my pipeline design canvas. You can see that the pipeline was triggered from the OneLake file, and that is how you use OneLake file triggers inside of Fabric. Thanks for watching.
We are excited to share that we've added parameterization support to the Spark job definition activity in Fabric data pipelines. Parameterization support allows for dynamic pipeline execution of SJD activity, meaning customers can now override their SJD artifact configurations, like the main definition file, reference files, and more, just from the data pipeline. Let's see this in action. In my pipeline, I'm going to add a new Spark job definition activity. Once it's added, I'll need to configure the settings and set up my connection, select my workspace, and choose an SJD artifact. If you don't have an SJD artifact created yet, you can click New and quickly create a new one from your data pipeline. Once you set a name, it'll take you to your SJD artifact to set your configurations. Let's go back to my pipeline. Here you can see that I already have a Spark job definition artifact set up. It's called My Spark Job Def. When I click open, I'm quickly navigated to my artifact and can view or edit my configurations. See that my main definition file here is Hello World and my reference file is Run Exception. Now, back to my SJD activity. What's new and exciting is this bottom section called Advanced Settings. Here's where you can dynamically set your SJD artifact configurations. Say I wanted to be able to set my reference file to something else. I can click Dynamic Content, create a new parameter for my updated reference file, and set the parameter as my expression. And I actually want to update my main definition file too. So I'll quickly make a new parameter for this as well and set the expression. Now I'm ready to run my pipeline. First, we need to save our pipeline, and then we can run it. Before running it, I just need to first add the values for my parameters. And once I've done that, I can click OK, and my pipeline will begin to run. And voila, you can see that my pipeline has run successfully. Let's go back and check my SJD artifact. Here, I can see all my runs, and I can take a closer look with my item snapshot. As you can see, in my most recent run, my main definition file was updated to updated main, and my reference file has been updated to runtime error.
Today, we'll view how the functions activity works inside of data pipelines. First, we'll need to make a user data function artifact. We'll use the preset HelloFabric function that takes in a parameter of name. This function will display a welcome message with the name parameter and current time. Let's publish it so that we can use the function in our data pipeline. Now let's create a data pipeline with a functions activity. We'll do this by navigating to pipeline activities and adding in functions. In settings, we'll leave the default type set to Fabric user data functions, and then we'll find our user data function artifact alongside our function. In the case of our Hello Fabric function, we have a parameter input name, so I'll input my name here as the value. Now, let's save and run our pipeline. We can confirm that our input value has the string value we set in our parameters in the settings of the functions activity. Let's also confirm that our output displays a welcome message with my name and also the current time. This aligns with our function we published in our user data function artifact. Thanks for watching today's demo on using the functions activity in data pipelines.
In this demo, we will show you how you can create powerful solutions with the new variable library item and data pipelines. Like other Fabric items, you'll need to set a name before you click Create. This will then create a new library that will list all your variables. Create a new variable and set your name and type. You can choose from Boolean, DateTime, GUID, Integer, Number, and String types. You can even add notes to better collaborate with your team. Once all that is configured, set your default value. You can also add alternative value sets, which will allow you to set variables to match your release stages in your CI/CD solution. Here, I'll add new value sets for a test and production stage, and then update the values corresponding to each stage. Let me add a few more variables. Once everything looks good, make sure to save your changes. Now, let's use some of these variables in my data pipeline. In the pipeline editor, you'll see a new section for library variables. Here is where you can create a reference to your library variables. All you need is a name, and then you can select from your existing variable libraries and the existing variables within that library. You'll see that the item type auto-populates. Now you can use your library variables in your data pipeline solution. For example, in my get metadata activity, I can set some dynamic content for my file path. In the expression builder, you'll see a new tab for library variables. Use these like you would any other parameter or variable. I'll go ahead and click on my folder, and you'll see that new library variable expression is populated. I'm going to go ahead and do the same for my directory. I can even use my library variables to parameterize my workspace artifacts like Lakehouse, Data Warehouse, and KQL Database. Here, I'm using my Lakehouse library variable, which holds my Lakehouse artifact ID. Once that's set, I'm also going to use my library variables to parameterize my Lakehouse table name. Now let's save this pipeline, run it, and see what happens. After successfully running, you'll see that the input folder path shows that the files are coming from variable library dev and the dev folder, which we've set as our default value. and you'll see that the data has been successfully copied to my lakehouse. Now let's see how we can use this with CI/CD. After opening my deployment pipeline, you can see that I have three stages: development, test, and production. I'll go ahead and select my variable library and pipeline to deploy from dev to test. And you'll see now that my test environment now has my variable library and pipeline. In my test workspace, I'll go ahead and open up my variable library, and I'll make sure to set the test value set as active. Now, when I go to run my pipeline, you'll see that the file path has been updated to variable library test and the test folder without me having to modify my pipeline. In my lakehouse, you can see that I also have a test table. As you can see, with variable library and data pipelines, you can really create powerful end-to-end data solutions.
Those demos were pretty awesome, right? Hit us up with your number one takeaway. And if you've got any questions, drop them where? In the comments below. Is there a specific demo you want to see next month? Let us know. And remember to like, comment, and subscribe to stay up to date on all the latest updates from Microsoft Fabric.